like a brand new pair of jeans. I feel like taking chances. I feel a lot like 17. Like when I close my eyes and don't even care if anyone sees me dancing. Like I can fly and don't even think of touching the ground. Like a heartbeat skip, like an open page. Like a one-way trip for an aeroplane. It's the way that I feel when I'm with you. Brand new. Ooh. Like when I close my eyes and don't even care if anyone sees me dancing. Like I can fly and don't even think of touching the ground. Like a heartbeat skip, like an open page. Like a one-way trip on an aeroplane. It's the way that I feel when I'm with you. Brand new.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet.
our worship in the Word in this passage of Scripture from the book of Hebrews. Let's say this together. Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. Therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us also lay aside every encumbrance and the sin which so easily entangles us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. Now, while we're getting ready to sing that next song, just find somebody close by that you've not yet spoken to and tell them you're glad to have them in worship with you this morning.
just one of the most powerful songs that's come into the life of the church in the last few months. Nan's going to help lead that. She's going to sing that first part of the verse, and then we're going to join together, church. We're going to allow the Spirit of God to wash over us this morning. Let's worship. join us this morning around this altar as we come and we bow down before the only holy and righteous God. His name is Jesus. And allow Him today to speak His truth.
Been those times, Father, where we heard the knock at the door or perhaps the doorbell ring and we screamed out, "Who is it?" Sometimes they would answer and sometimes they wouldn't. We'd have to peep through the peephole and decide if we wanted to let them in. You gave us your word in the book of Revelation and you painted that picture to one of the churches and you said, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock." And that's true for us as believers. You want in. You want access to every part of who we are. And it may be that we shout back, "It's not a good time. I'm not ready." It could be because there are some things in there that we'd really rather you not see or be a part of. Those strongholds that we've just sung about. Things that have got a hold of our life that we've let creep in that we like, we enjoy. They're fun, they're good, and they're embarrassing, and they're powerful, and we're having trouble finding a way to let go of them so that you can come in and be a little bit more powerful and a little bit more in control. So my prayer is this morning, Father, that we would have the willingness to open the door, say, "Come on in." The humility to let you see what we already know and what you already know. That you can break down some of those strongholds, whether it's just being addicted to our stuff, or maybe it is that we are consumed by alcohol or an illegal drug or a prescription drug. It may be that we're more concerned about what our people think than about what you think. It may be that we're caught up in pornography. A lot of different things are out there that can become those strongholds in our life that just take us away from you and keep us from experiencing what you've prepared for us. So I pray again what we've just sung together. Break every stronghold. Come on in and do what you alone are capable of doing. Change us, Father. Set us free. Get us out of that mess. Release us from the entanglements of those choices and help us to be free because of you and what you continue to do in us. We ask that because of and in the powerful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
I invite you to stand and let's worship together.
We can hear by
Oh, yeah. All right, let's go back to the mid to late 80s, even early 90s, long before any of you were born. But let's take a quick trip down memory lane. Boring day in Mount Pleasant, time to kill, and a desire to do a little shopping. Where shall we go? Well, not to Texarkana, no. Not to Longview, no. Let's go to Mesquite, Town East Mall, the shopping mecca. And we would drive over and we would stop at the only convenience store that had reasonably clean bathrooms and a reasonably good supply of snacks. It was the little gas station truck stop over there that had a Subway attached to it. Do y'all remember that? When that was our only choice between here and Mesquite, and we would go to the mall and spend the day. Oh, you might have something in mind, some target that you were shopping for, but a lot of times you were just meandering around, window shopping, as it were, waiting for something to capture your eye, and then you had to decide, what are we going to do about this? Well, sometimes the question that was the prerequisite question was, well, how much is it going to cost? Sometimes that was put off until later. But then the question, well, does it do what I want it to do? Is it going to accomplish the goal if you knew what that was? And then, do I like the way it looks or feels? You might find yourself being the person on the outside, while the person on the inside went in to try on the outfit. And they would come out and they were expecting a reaction, and the reaction they were looking for was not, it looks fine. They hated that. And so you had to give a more descriptive reaction. Oh, baby, you look good in that. Oh, my goodness, you look hot in that. Oh, my goodness, that just captures the color in your eye. And you could be sure when you said something like that, they were going to buy not one, but two in two different colors, and you'd be going home with them. But sometimes they'd come out and say, how does this look? Now, they didn't want to hear that, but you were trying to be honest. I don't think that's your color. It's a good way of saying, it looks bad, baby. It's just not, no. But ultimately, you come back around to, can we afford it? Well, what will I have to do to be able to afford it? Because if I really want it, I can find a way to get what I want. That's the way shopping works. Isaiah was writing to not just a small group of people. It was a large audience. This was a word that was going to be passed around, and they would get it in time. But it was a word about this very phenomenon. But he wasn't talking about going to a mall. He was talking about shopping for a god, choosing a god. They were displaced. They had been moved as a people because of war, because of the reparations of war. They had been moved from home, from Jerusalem, to a place called Babylon. And there they had been planted. They weren't prisoners of war. They were simply transplanted and forced to settle down and stay a while. Some said it won't last long, but God had said, hang on, it's going to last 70 years. So go ahead and build your houses and plant your gardens and let your kids marry and carry on with life because it's going to be a season. But while they were there, they were exposed to some things they'd never seen around home. They were exposed to some choices that had never been available to them. And so here they were trying to decide between this and this, between something that was new and exciting, enticing, and something that was a little old. Maybe a little mossy around the edges. And would it still work? Would the old still suffice, or did they need to go hook, line, and sinker with the new? Or perhaps they could create this synthesis of the two. That's what Isaiah 46 is about. And our students had their weekend built around the passage, Isaiah 46, 9. And you're going to hear that as I read through. I want to read the chapter. Follow along as Isaiah speaks to the audience. He said about those gods, those new gods, Baal has bowed down, Nebo stoops over, their images are consigned to the beasts and the cattle. The things that you carry are burdensome, a load for the weary beast. They stooped over, they bowed down together, they could not rescue the burden, but they have themselves gone into captivity. Listen to me, O house of Jacob, and all the remnant of the house of Israel, you who have been born by me from birth and have been carried from the womb. Even to your old age, I will be the same. And even to your graying years, I will bear you. I've done it, and I will carry you, and I will bear you, and I will deliver you. To whom would you liken me? And make me equal and compare me that we would be alike. Those who lavish gold from the purse and weigh silver on the scale, hire a goldsmith and he makes it into a god. They bow down. Indeed, they worship it. They lift it upon the shoulder and carry it. They set it in its place and it stands there. It doesn't move from its place. Though one may cry to it, it cannot answer. It cannot deliver him from his distress. So remember this and be assured. Recall it to mind, you transgressors, lawbreakers, those who step outside the bounds of what is right. Remember the former things long past, for I am God, and there's no other. I am God, and there's no one like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from ancient times things which have not been done, saying, my purpose will be established, and I will accomplish all my good pleasure, calling a bird of prey from the east, the man of my purpose from a far country. Truly I've spoken. Truly I will bring it to pass. I've planned it. Surely I will do it. Listen to me, you stubborn-minded, you who are far from righteousness. I bring near my righteousness. It's not far off, and my salvation will not delay. And I will grant salvation in Zion and my glory for Israel. Choosing a God. Three questions that I think Isaiah implied, and I want to be explicit in those questions. First one is this: how much of the load are you carrying? I get that question out of his description of these two gods. Baal has bowed down. Nebo stoops over. Here's the picture. These icons, these carved pieces of stone or carved pieces of wood that have been decorated, they are enormous. They represent their deity. They represent their God. But when it's time to have a particular festival, or if there's a need to move them to a new location, then we've got to call in the troops. We've got to have a work day. And we've got to decide how we're going to get these things from point A to point B. And so they gather around and they lean it over carefully, place it on a wagon affixed to beasts of burden, and they tie it down. They lash it so it doesn't fall off and become scratched or defaced or even broken. And then they carry it. They pull it to the new location, carefully removing it now from the wagon, propping it up to make sure it doesn't fall over and crush anybody. And when it's standing upright and when they feel like it's secure, then and only then are they able to gather around and begin again to worship it. And Isaiah said, what's wrong with that picture? I mean, your God is dependent on you to move it. Your God is dependent on you to carry it to its next location, to the next place of worship. Your God is dependent on you to make sure it doesn't topple over. And when you've done all of that, then you feel comfortable bowing down and worshiping that God. What is wrong with that picture? Baal, the same title as Baal, which means Lord, is the patron god of Babylon. His son, Nebo, was the patron of nearby Borsippa. He was the god of wisdom. Now he is a piece of stone. He is a piece of wood carved, perhaps, and the god of wisdom, carried annually to Babylon to accompany his father in the New Year processions and to write on tables of destiny. This inanimate object was going to write on tables of destiny and tell the folk what was coming in the new year. Makes no sense at all. You say, well, we don't do that. Do we not? I mean, there's a business on the south side of town down here. I've passed it thousands of times. And I'm curious, never have stopped. But I've wondered sometimes when I was not sure about what was going to happen in the church next, wondering when I wasn't sure about the future of our plans for the next few weeks or months or years, would it be advantageous to stop there and offer my palm to the palm reader? And maybe because of the lines on my palm, maybe she could tell me, oh, pastor, in the next 6 months, your church is going to, oh, pastor, in the next year, your church is going to, and I could come back and say, have I got a word for you? Have I got a word from you? Now, if she's not good with palms, maybe she's good with tea leaves. We can brew a cup of tea, and I can take a few sips and leave the tea leaves to settle in the bottom of my cup, and maybe then she can tell me what my future holds. You say, well, that's a bit silly, Pastor. Oh, it is. It's silly. It certainly is. It borders on stupidity, but it doesn't keep us from doing it, because we're trying to find that something that will give to us what we need. And that's what Isaiah was depicting here. And they were having to carry the bulk of the load. Their God needed them to get it to the next location. Their God needed them to be propped up. Their God needed them fundamentally to have any power in their life. And that's what we do. Our gods are different. They are anything or anybody, any circumstance to which we give power over our life. Oh, I need that. I need you to affirm me. I need that to make me feel good about myself. I need that to have some enjoyment. I need that to have some security. It could be any one of a number of things, but any of it is that thing, that somebody, that something that we have said, you are that valuable to me, and I don't know that I will be well, whole, right, apart from you. And so our question is, how much are we willing to carry of that load? How much are we willing to prop up our God? How much are we willing to invest them with? These gods can only carry you as far as you are willing to allow. Now I want to draw a contrast. And Isaiah was doing kind of a new God, old God contrast here. And I get that. It's fitting. He said, contrast that with our God, Jehovah God, who doesn't need anything from you. That's kind of hard. We'd like to think that God really needs us. But I'll just be frank with you. God doesn't need Clint Davis to do his business. God doesn't need First Baptist Church to do his business. And guess what? God doesn't need you to do his business. But here's the good news. Because God is who he is, he has chosen us, invited us to know him and to be a part of what he's doing. And we don't have to prop him up. And we don't have to carry him along to his new location. I promise you that years ago when we moved from downtown out here, we didn't have to commission a special moving van to come in and find God in one of the closets and move him into that van and then bring him out here and put him back into the new God closet. God has never been consigned to a closet. I don't need you, he would say, and said to them, but oh my, do you need me? Do you need me? In fact, in the early pages of the Bible, in the book of Exodus, when he was given this Ten Commandments, he said to the children of Israel, don't you ever make a graven image and then worship it. Don't you ever create something and call it me and bow down to it. Don't you ever do that. Because I am bigger than any piece of rock, bigger than any piece of carved wood. I can never be contained in any one house. I am the Lord your God. And you shall have no other gods before me. Well, that brings us to the second question. What do you expect from your God? Isaiah pointed out the fallacy of depending on that piece of rock, that piece of stone. God spoke, to whom would you liken me and make me equal and compare me that we would be alike? Those who lavish gold from the purse and weigh silver on the scale, hire a goldsmith and he makes it into a god. They bow down, indeed they worship it. They lift it upon the shoulder and carry it. They set it in its place and it stands there. It does not move from its place. Though one may cry to it, and they did, it cannot answer. It cannot deliver him from his distress. What do you expect from your God? And yeah, in the bulletin and on the screen, that's a little g God, because anything other than Jehovah God is a little g God, an idol, if you will. You say, well, Clint, and we are God worshipers. We're not, your message is displaced. Well, hold your little horses. Because the fact is, what Isaiah was dealing with were a group of people who were holding on to old God, Jehovah God, while at the same time dabbling in new God. Because old God could at times be stuffy. Old God could be rigid. And, well, frankly, old God could be no fun. New God, Baal, Nebo, they were exciting. They had places of worship. They had activities in worship that were mind-blowing, that would shake your world. They appeal to all the senses, to your eyes and to your ears and to your taste. They appeared to the impulses of your body. They drew you in like a bug to a light. It was exciting. And so the idea was not we're going to reject old God. It was simply that we're going to spice up old God with a generous dose of new God. And somehow create a synthesis of the two together. And I get that. I understand that. Because sometimes old ways are a bit stodgy. Old ways are a little bit boring. Old ways are, well, they're just old. And let's be honest. Y'all look around. There are some old people in this room. There are some old people. They haven't always been old. They got that way. It took time. Okay? But they've become old now, and old people can be set in their ways, and sometimes, yeah, they can be a bit boring. Because I'm one of them. And then I realize sometimes people come to church and they say, well, Pastor, I've had these conversations, Pastor, I don't think we're going to be joining your church. Why? Well, I just don't feel like we're being led to join your church. No, that's not a good one. Why? Why aren't you coming? Well, you got a lot of old people. But it's not like we serve milk of magnesia for the Lord's Supper. I mean, we don't have comfort stations with Depends out there in a dispenser. We got old people. I need a church that's more with it. I need flashing lights, and I need a little smoke every now and then. I need loud music. And a preacher who can pull off skinny jeans and pointy-toed shoes. I need a preacher who's free enough to take his shirt tail out every now and then. You don't fit the bill, brother. You're for old people. And I listen to them and I say, I know. But old people know how to have fun. Amen? Okay, here's the problem. Old people know how to have fun. It's a hearing issue, and we just have to overcome that. But the idea has been perpetuated by the prince of the power of darkness, Satan himself. The idea has been perpetuated that you can't follow old God, Bible God, and enjoy life. You got to know him, because you don't want to go to hell. No, nobody desires to go to hell. There's very few people out there who would say, well, I just want to go to hell. Most people want to go to heaven when they die, and they want to have that insurance policy. I've got enough of old God to get me to heaven, so whoo. But I like the new God philosophy as well. I like to have some fun, whatever that means, you know. I like to go to those places. I like to do those things. I like to dabble in those ideas. I like to have a little fun. And still know that I'm going to go to heaven. And Isaiah simply was raising this question, in dabbling with, in playing with the new God, are you risking losing that sense of old God, true God, being God of your life, Lord of your life? Are you risking losing that direction that God is able to give? Are you risking losing that dynamism, that life that comes from following Him and walking with Him? Are you risking losing? In fact, Jesus said in John chapter 10, the thief, the enemy, I mean, he comes with all of his stuff, all of his bright, shiny baubles. He comes with all of his attractions, all of his enticements to come and have fun. Because we know that girls and boys just want to have fun. We know that. Come and have fun. He said the thief comes to steal and to kill and to destroy at the end of the day. But I came that they might have life and have it abundantly. Life, not just existence, not hanging on to the end of the road, not I want to go to heaven, not to hell. It is life. Life that's overflowing. I want to enjoy my time here. I want to enjoy my reason for being. I want to enjoy the relationships that you brought into my life. I want my life to have reason and purpose. And so when he said, I've come that you might have life, a life that is literally running over from the inside out, it turns the whole idea upside down, that life is not generally about being consumptive, about being a consumer, about having all the good things come to me and me enjoying life. It is about something happening inside of me that so changes my perspective that I realize that life is not about amassing, accumulating, piling up, and consuming. Life ultimately is about giving myself away because of Jesus in me. What do you expect from your God? That brings me to the third question. We'll wind up with this one. How much of you does God have? Remember this and be assured, Isaiah wrote in verse 8, recall it to mind, you transgressors, you who've stepped outside the bounds. Remember the former things long past, for I am God and there's no other. I am God and there's no one like me. We get to those places and we know things aren't right. We know that something needs to change. And so we might pray a prayer like this. God, would you please just give me another little helping of you? I need a little bit more of God in my life. Sometimes you get out of whack and you think, well, I just need to go to church a little bit more. I just need to read my Bible a little bit more. I need to start trying to pray more regularly. I need a little bit more of God in my life. Here's the reality, and listen carefully. I don't want to confuse you, but you either have God in your life or you don't have God in your life. And if you have God in your life, you have all of God you're ever going to have. Hang with me. The question is not how much of God do you have? The question is how much of you does God have? How much of you does God have? Because he gives himself to us. Again, Jesus' words, I've come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. I want to fill your life. I want to give you everything that is the essence of life. And so the question becomes, how much of ourselves have we opened up to him? How many rooms, if we want to make it a house, how many rooms of our life have we opened the door and said, come on in? But it's a mess. Well, I know. Let's get that cleaned up, you and I together. Let me give you some direction. And he helps us to clean out some things that don't need to be there. And maybe we've got some areas of our life where we are misguided. We're chasing some things that rather than being a blessing to God and leading us into his life, they are literally eroding us. They are wearing us down. They are taking us apart piece by piece by piece. And he steps in and he says, let's take a good look at that. You really want that? Well, yeah, look at it. You see what it's doing to you? Yeah, but no, do you really want that? Nah. All right, let's get rid of it. Let's clean that out. And we're not just going to clean that out. When we take away something, when the Lord takes something out of our life, he brings something more powerful and better and puts it in his place. The Christian life is not a vacuum where you just stop doing bad things. That doesn't work. It's that he cleans that out and he brings something in to take its place. How much of you does God have? Your mind, your thoughts, the things that you go to when you lay there at night and you're staring at the ceiling? Does he have your heart, your soul, that spiritual part of you that cries out for something that is beyond you, for someone who's bigger than you, wanting to connect and to know him in that way that will change you, yeah, from the inside out and progressively change you? There's no instantaneous discipleship, y'all. We can't bring you in here on a weekend and dose you up with some special concoction and send you out of here a fully developed disciple. That doesn't happen. Discipleship is a process. It's a lifelong commitment to walk with the Lord and to let him grow you up into who he wants you to be. And the question is, are you willing daily to wake up and say, here I am, Lord, I'm reporting for duty and I'm ready for you to do something today in my life that you alone are able to do? Does he have your soul? Does he have your will? Your willingness to say, yeah, count me in. There was no strain of Just As I Am playing in the background. There was nobody leading the congregation to sing, Have Thine Own Way, Lord, but it was an invitation. Isaiah offered an invitation. Through the words of God, what are you going to do? You got on the one side the new gods, Baal and Nebo, and the other side the old God, Jehovah God. You got the God that you are having to prop up and you're having to take care of, and then you've got the God who has given you life and who's never changed. Same God that was there when you were born, you were a newborn or a wrinkly little bundle of flesh, and he's still there when you're old and gray, and he'll be there long after you're gone. That's the God that's offering you his life. So what's the next step? Where do we go from here for the Lord to do in us what he desires to do? Heavenly Father, we are blessed to have been a part of a great weekend. We are blessed to experience your word. And I pray this morning that you've spoken clearly, that your Holy Spirit has had the freedom to move among us, to point out things, to touch sensitive areas of our life, to shine light on dark places, and to give us direction for that next step. And so, Lord, as we come to this last song, this invitation, we offer it. And I pray that anybody who wants to take that next step of faith, be that making a profession of faith, coming for baptism, coming to be a member of the church. Father, whatever it might mean, let's take that next step together. We pray it in Jesus' name.